Hello soldiers, I'm King Link and it's time to review Call of Duty World War II. Now Call of Duty is actually a pretty long running series, at least it feels that way. It's only about 16 years old at this point, starting in 2003, and yet we've had a yearly title almost every year except for 2004 and, well, 2018. It's really hard for me to call Black Ops 4 a mainline game, but you can of course watch my video about that. Now, Call of Duty World War II came out in 2017, and the reason we're talking about it today is due to it being part of the Humble Monthly Bundle for November 2019. So I guess I'm covering another Call of Duty title, and honestly, I'm kind of glad to. Before we dive in, though, I do have to disclose something. I was officially offered a job to work with Sledgehammer Games around 2016. Technically, that position must have been to work on Call of Duty World War II, though they wouldn't announce the actual name to me. I ended up choosing not to take that position, and in hindsight, I think that was the right choice, but as always, I try to announce my potential conflicts of interest up front, and there we are. And at the same time, if you like this review as we go on, definitely consider subscribing to me. It means the world to me, and I would absolutely appreciate it. So back to the game. There's a ton to talk about here. This is going to be a longer review, but let's get on with it. And while it's 2 years old, I find that Call of Duty games don't age that much. And by that I mean playing the game in 2019 isn't a bad experience, and the fact is World War II is just as impressive today as it was back in 2017. Now, let's start where every World War II game starts, Normandy. Yeah, we're going to conveniently ignore Pearl Harbor, all of Africa, and Italy, and spoiler, not really spoiler, we also forget about Japan. You know, I get it. Nazis are bad, and I'm not going to question it here. It's World War II, you're going to kill Nazis. But be prepared for a game we've seen already a few times, even in this franchise. Call of Duty 1, 2, and 3 all covered this part of the war, and I might even said looked at it for more than just an American Nazi conflict. There's really not a lot of British, French here, and of course there's absolutely no Russia in this part of the war. Of course, as you're already seeing on the screen, this isn't what we've played before. Normandy here is pretty bad. Normandy was not a good day or really month in real life. The results were great, of course, but during the battle, about a quarter of a million people died, evenly split between both sides, and the game kind of gets that. There are absolutely horrific moments, and yeah, it's bloody, bad, and it's not a place I'd ever want to be. So, kudos to Sledgehammer for such a realistic depiction of this part of the war. The rest of the game still looks pretty good. It has some dark feeling to some of it. This isn't really a celebration of war as a good thing. There's actually not many happy moments in this campaign, and its tone is pretty dark. However, on screen now, there's a scene that really shines, in my opinion. For some reason, I was convinced that this was actors, not CG. It's clearly not. The detail is really good, though. And the game can look like this often in cutscenes, and I want to call that out. At the same time, multiplayer is good. High action, lot of motion and feeling, but it works well for what it is, just an insane romp. And the Nazi zombie mode is dark and filled with zombies, which is also appropriate. These are what you would expect them to be, and, you know, kudos are due. It works for what they are. The strange thing to me is this opening for zombies on the screen. It has both Ving Rhames and David Tennant. As I mentioned in my preview about this, they kind of stand out. They look great, but I can't stop seeing Ving Rhames, and Tennant is a little bit better, but to me he's always going to be Doctor Who, or technically Kilgrave from Jessica Jones. He's a really good actor, though. And if we're talking about actors, well, you can't really talk about Call of Duty World War II without bringing up Josh Duhamel, if that's how you say it. He's the guy on the screen right now, Mr. Heartthrob from like a ton of movies. He does stand out, and it becomes a bit of a problem for me because he's so noticeable. You know, he's a modern actor, and he doesn't really fit in when he's in many of these scenes. It's just the notable Hollywood actor and other guys. Sticking with him, though, the fact is, I really applaud him here. He's a solid actor, and I honestly think he did a great job with the script in Call of Duty World War II. At the same time, I don't know if the character works here. Call of Duty World War II is set in one of the most important and iconic wars of all time. Just having major moments and random characters could have worked, like Call of Duty 2, for instance. Instead, Activision and Sledgehammer decided to focus on Josh Duhamel's character, along with his superior. Duhamel is playing a character named Pearson, and his boss is Turner, if you hear him talking about him. The thing is, There's so much of the game focuses on Pearson and the main character Daniels as well. There's a little bit more with the third character named Zussman, a Jewish American who also speaks a little bit of German. You know, one guess where that's going to go, and you're right, no surprises there. The thing is, the story here feels more like Apocalypse Now, or a video game version of that, which they already had in Spec Ops The Line and Far Cry 2. But seriously, why couldn't World War II just be the basis of the game? Why not focus more on the actual horrors of the real war? And instead, they built Pearson, but there's no reason for that story, and I don't think it works as well in World War II as it would in Vietnam or Korea. The setting is already a very interesting moment in time, and they kind of lose out on that. It doesn't help much that the reveal is that Pearson is a bit of a control freak in some ways, but it doesn't go that dark. He sees missions that he feels has to be done, and then he pushes his men to accomplish them, and doesn't do much wrong. You see, there's only two or three moments where the player can say Pearson moves too far, and even then, he quickly redeems himself. At times, it feels like Pearson's story is the most important thing in the game and we're going to finally understand him at a deeper level. And 5 minutes later, characters change to push a different level narrative, and it just changes. I believe many levels in this game were probably done by individual designers who weren't deciding on one overarching story, which explains why the story isn't the strongest at times. But it's never good enough to warrant all of this. The biggest issue, though, is that the Act 1 of the story doesn't exist. Pearson is almost always teetering on the brink of insanity in the game and falls in finally. Okay, that's the end of the movie, but the characters don't evolve enough to tell that story. There's really no beginning or middle to this descent, we just know that this is the path we're on. Now, as for the game itself, all the big moments here, especially from the European campaign in World War II. We've seen Normandy, we have the Ardennes Forest, and spoiler, but not really, there's a concentration camp because, of course, there is, it's World War II. Though the game does talk about a real one, it seems to want to focus more on that it's a POW camp, not a Jewish concentration camp, and that camp is named Buchwald. Now, you can look it up. The problem is, almost everything this game does is wrong in this case. They make this the epilogue. There's almost no one alive when the soldiers get there, which isn't true at all about the actual camp. It's most definitely a concentration camp, not the POW camp. And probably not many POWs. We're talking about 200,000 people over time were in this camp. Concentration camps are one of those things, you know, it's about the worst thing you can do or show, and the fact is, it's wrong to ignore it, but you also should try to be truthful about it and not dramatize it for your story. Call of Duty World War II tries to dramatize it and makes it personal, but it ignores everything else and ultimately fails, which makes this scene in particular very cringeworthy. Call of Duty World War II also decides to pull a twist at this point, which is actually unrelated to the camp or the game itself. Without giving away the twist, I will say it adds nothing to the game, and I couldn't have guessed the twist because what they twist has very little purpose to the story as a whole. The thing is, there's this idea that there will be twists no matter what in Call of Duty. You know, you get shot at the end of a major dark mission in the original Modern Warfare, you get nuked, your best friend dies, and you have to press F to pay respects. This is a common theme in these games, but the series as a whole has become a bit like M. Night Shyamalan as a director in that every game has to have a twist, even if it doesn't add anything to the game itself. Having a twist because you have to have a twist is a bad idea, and yeah, the twist here doesn't help anything. I'm not going to talk more about it, but yeah, that's the one. Overall, though, the acting in this game is good, but the story here, there's just no reason for most of it. They're overcomplicating what could have stood on its own. World War II is well known, but playing through it and understanding the war itself has enough drama that you didn't need to make up a story to add to it. On the other hand, Nazi Zombies does have a bit of a story. It's a little bit more progression-based, where the player activates certain things to push the story forward, opens up new areas, and so on. And this actually works. I found this story to be far better than what I had seen recently in Black Ops 4, and it made me want to play the mode more. Though, admittedly, losing all your progress every time your team fails does make it a little more annoying, but this is something you can enjoy at your own pace, whereas Black Ops 4 had you guess random stuff. Now, let's finally talk about the gameplay, and of course, this is Call of Duty. Call of Duty World War II is like every Call of Duty game. You run around, shoot enemies, and advance on their locations. You hit the right buttons to do some action and move on to the next location. It's a typical shooter. Though, this time around, they actually have QTEs. That's right, quick time events are back. They don't appear that often, at most once or twice a level, not that much more. But it's too often for 2019, or 2017, really. The correct number, of course, should have been zero, and they don't add much to the game, except for ways for you to die for no reason, but you didn't do some small action fast enough. There's also no recovering health, which does sound bad, but I didn't have any problem with normal difficulty. There's actually a really good health system that requires you to hit 6 on the keyboard or down on the D-pad, I believe, while in cover. It's an interesting system, not the best of course, but it's a nice change of pace for gamer 2, and it allows you to heal up as you need. Now, Call of Duty as a franchise, though, is really just a theme park for video games. You go through some levels, shooting enemies, getting to the next interesting section, where you might be on a tank or a turret, driving cars, or more. The car chases in particular here are actually quite good, and I applaud them. They're fun and fast and perfect for the series. On the same time, not everything felt great. Driving a tank around oddly sucked. The tank would turn independent of the gun, and it became frustrating to move the turret around to blast enemies. The enemies actually had to be attacked from this side, and I'm showing it, and I really just didn't enjoy this section, and I've heard the same from other people. A small note here. It's possible that the controls of the tank are particularly poor on the PC and might not have the same issues on console. I'm not sure. I was playing with a mouse and keyboard on PC. That's the best I can tell you, but it was very frustrating. Similarly, I like airplane games. I still need to cover Ace Combat 7. I need to go back and do that. But there's a flight segment in World War II. I won't show it here, but I'm just not a huge fan of that one either, especially because it forced a third-person view that felt unnatural, especially for a flying game. Now, overall, though, there are great moments here. And as a theme park, you know, it was fun to play through. Fighting and major offensives were fun. The turret section is good, and there's good shooting and sniping galleries. The single player really worked for the most part. In addition, they've also added in heroic actions and mementos to the single player campaign. The mementos are just collectibles, and they're kind of hard to find, but they are what you expect. Small little Trotskys that you can look at later if you really want to. Eh. And on the other hand, heroic actions are interesting moments where you can do something major to help another soldier, whether it be killing an attacker, dragging them out of the line of fire, but they really don't do much other than award an achievement. I think they mostly recharge special abilities. Speaking of those special abilities, they're a huge improvement here. Each of your major squad mates have a special ability. Pearson, for instance, can spot enemies. Zussman will give you a health pack. Someone else will give you grenades or ammo or mortar shell markers. Your teammates actually have a purpose here, and it's a strong part of the game because now suddenly you care who you're standing with or near. Yet, there's still no risk of them getting injured, so it's just a way for you to get some more items or ammo depending on where you are. But it ultimately works. Now, there are also three back-to-back missions in Call of Duty World War II that had some level of stealth in it, which probably was two missions too many. Maybe three. There is an interesting one where you go undercover as a French resistance fighter that should be on the screen, but it goes on far too long and tries to build a story that only really appears for about 30 minutes and ultimately doesn't matter to the main story. The other two stealth sections had even less purpose. One of the levels could have probably worked on its own, but after three, you know, I just didn't find it as necessary. And ultimately, that's the single-player game. Now, of course, there's still multiplayer and zombies. Multiplayer is just what you would expect. Decent-sized map and teams, it's actually quite lively right now, whether that's because of the Humble Monthly Bundle deal, or just people going back to this after playing Black Ops 4, I don't know, but I actually easily found matches at all times of the night, even when it would have been impossible to play in Black Ops 4 even as it came out as the Humble Monthly Bundle. One of the two big modes here for me was Shipment 1944, which is just an uber small map, perfect for farming kills or having a good time. If you know any of the shipments, this is just right up the same alley. The other major mode is called Ground War, which is four objectives placed back to back, and one team was going to complete all four objectives in order or is stalled long enough for the time to run out, and then the two switch sides and the other team attacks. Honestly, I think Ground War is pretty solid. The one piece I really like in this game is having to retreat or attack when an objective is lost. Now, there is a new idea in multiplayer of divisions, which gives some bonuses, and it's just yet another thing to level up. Rather than just building out a ton of challenges that always gave you something to work towards, there's now fewer challenges and a new system called orders. And you can take orders, which will give you rewards for completing them. Like, kill 200 people and you'll get something. But for me though, orders just doesn't do enough. Not enough happens each mission, and I think back to games like the original Modern Warfare, where every map and game felt like you accomplished some objective. Even just killing 3 or 4 people in one life was a major feat, and it would reward you for that. Now it feels more like you're grinding to earn these little bonuses that don't happen that often. If you really like multiplayer, I'm sure you'll have a good time here, of course, but I see the grind more and more in each Call of Duty game I play. But, of course, we also have to talk about something else. There's microtransactions. Now, if you like loot boxes, you can chase down orders and hope you'll complete them so you can earn loot boxes, or, of course, you can go buy loot boxes, whether they be for the Nazi zombie mode or multiplayer. And if you want, you can open those loot boxes in the HQ system, which is like a mini level that you and friends can run around, and it's based on Normandy, so they're making you open your loot boxes on a bloody battlefield, and yeah, it's a bit distasteful. What you earn isn't that valuable in the first place, but it's the pieces that people show off when they win the game. You know, those awesome little taunts people will use just to show how great they are, but really it just means they opened up enough boxes. That's what's in the loot boxes. Now, you can earn the loot boxes in multiplayer. At least one player earns a loot box every game, but, you know, this stuff should have just been normal level rewards. I don't think the loot boxes in Call of Duty World War II add anything to the game, but that shouldn't surprise anyone. Nazi Zombies, on the other hand, is more story-based, like I mentioned, but it's still killing zombies. The mode does get quite hard, and it becomes repetitive, to the point that I played through it twice, and I felt like I was done. They also have the order system, the unlockable, the loot boxes, and more here. You know, I'm not a big fan of those, obviously. The biggest thing, though, is that there's only one map available in the base game that is what's in the Humble Monthly Bundle or that you buy normally. You can buy 3 more zombie maps as DLC or maybe through the Season Pass, but nah, you know, I'm good. Overall, though, Call of Duty World War II is a solid game. There's a lot here, and if you enjoy the series, you can have a ton of fun with this one. The story is a bit of a mess, but the minute-to-minute pieces of the gameplay are fun. Multiplayer is solid if you go for that, and the same is true for zombies. I think it's the best zombie version I've ever played in a Call of Duty game. Just not something I wanted to play a ton of, but that's understandable. Now, overall, I gotta say, Call of Duty World War II is actually a pretty fun game. Just nothing that really stood out for me, and I think they could have done much of it better. The weak story definitely hurts here, and the microtransactions aren't doing Activision or any game company any favors at this point in time. I do, however, give Call of Duty World War II a 3.5 out of 5. You know, World War II is really good, but the score is just because I know Call of Duty can do better. Heck, I know Advanced Warfare, also developed by Sledgehammer, was a better game in my opinion. And as awful as Kevin Spacey is as a person, I still think that story is a higher point than World War II's story. But even if you have played too many World War II shooters, you know, this version's pretty good for the grittiness of the scenes, if not the story. That's my look, though, at Call of Duty World War II. What do you think? As part of the Humble Monthly Bundle, you are currently getting this game, Spyro, and Crash for $12. That's honestly a fantastic deal, especially at that price. I think this game's worth it. I will be returning soon to talk about all 3 games in the Humble Monthly Bundle in a recap, and if you want to hear more from me, I'm thrilled. Consider subscribing, it always means a lot to me. Throw me a thumbs up or thumbs down, I understand if that's how you're feeling, and feel free to comment if the mood hits you, or you want to tell me how to pronounce Duhamel. We'll throw up my review of Black Ops 4 if you want to see what I think of the other Call of Duties that recently came out. I'll link to my Spyro Reignited trilogy as well, you know I'm a big fan of that game. Until next time, I'm King Link, and thank you for watching.